context before you.
Sure.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here to share with you some of my experiences which touch on a number of things, including intellectual property rights. I have had I'm sorry I came in late. I was in Addis Ababa for an emergency meeting of the Board of Trustees of a center based in Malawi, which is now being governed by the African Union. That center manufactures a vaccine against a disease called East Coast Fever, which destroys cows, especially in Eastern and Southern Africa. So I had to go for that meeting and arrived this morning. Now, what do I want to share with you? I want to share with you a little bit of my life history to illustrate a number of issues that are coming up. One, I got interested in research when I was a second year medical student. Actually, first year medical student. And I was recruited by my professor of microbiology as a student research assistant. So throughout my life in the medical school, I was doing research. And one of the areas that we concentrated was on a virus which had just been discovered 2 years earlier by a gentleman called Baruch Bloomberg, and it was hepatitis B virus. And we got into it, and we did a lot of epidemiological research because our interest was in the epidemiology of the hepatitis B, using hepatitis B surface antigen as the marker. Developed the tests for it. We identified patients that had extremely high titers of hepatitis B virus. And because we were only interested in publishing, we just published and published and published. Only later to know that in fact, if we had had an electronic centrifuge, we could have separated that virus, because we knew that we could inactivate it using formaldehyde. But we didn't go beyond that. And then Merck came along and made the first vaccine against hepatitis B, which was just to add formaldehyde, which we were doing, ultracentrifuge, and they got the vaccine. But the point is that in academia and in research, your focus is the golden rule, which is you publish or you perish. So, the more you publish, the more rewards you get in terms of international recognition amongst your peers, you get invited to various conferences, and you have access to the possibility of getting research grants. You also get promotion, and you get salary rises, especially if you're in the research institutions. But that is the golden rule. What at that time we're not stressing was the issue of IP. When I moved from the hepatitis B, then I got interested in diagnostics. So I developed a diagnostic test and published. I got my recognition for publishing in a good journal, and a year later, actually literally months later, somebody in Antwerp got it and turned it into a commercial product, which they sell up to the present day. Did I get a recognition for that? No. I didn't. So, while you're doing research, today you also pay attention to the social context of your research, possible implications of your research findings, and so on. So when I developed additional diagnostic technologies, I said, okay, now I'm wiser. Let me go and talk to the patent lawyers. I did that in London. And the patent lawyers looked at all the information that I had, and they said, but you already published part of this. So it's going to be difficult now to process an IP on this. So what do you suggest? They told me, what you do is you go and turn it into a commercial product and keep the rest of the information as industrial secret. And you just go ahead. By the time somebody else tries to catch up, you'll be so ahead that it will not make sense for them to also turn it into a commercial product. But it's a tall order. To develop that into a commercial product requires many things. One is capital. In our countries, access to capital is not easy because the commercial banks will charge you the commercial rate. In Uganda, it's about 27% interest rate. You go for that and you are dead meat. What other countries do is that the government actually supports you to develop this through the development banks, where you can get the money at a lower rate rather than the commercial rate. They do that. But in our part of the world, it's not easy. Capital is the first problem. Second, the human capital itself is an issue because you have to pick up people, you have to pick up young people, train them in order for you to sell your idea to them and let them contribute to what you want to develop. That also takes time. I didn't end at that. Continue with my research. I got on vaccine development. And in vaccine development, identified a molecule on the sporozoite of the parasite that kills cattle called East Coast fever. It was novel. So we applied for IP. We got the IP. But there were controversies about that, and I want you to know this. That when you're doing research, make sure that you have got a book with the page numbers and you record everything as you go along, because it matters at the end when you apply for the intellectual property right. In my case, somebody tried to copy this and get an intellectual property right on it without my name. And I only got to know about it because I happened to be a signatory on all foreign checks. And this bill came in from a patent office in the US for filing a patent. And in that institute, I knew that nobody else had had a patent. So when I called for the more information from finance, they discovered that in fact it was mine. How did I save it? It's because I had been recording everything from inception of the concept to all the steps for trying this out, recording the results, what next, and record that in a continuous process. That's what you must do, and that's what saved my patent. However, what happened to the development of the vaccine after the copyright? Now that's another ball game. Whoever we approached, they said, oh, but this disease affects only a few countries. Those countries are poor. They will not be able to afford to pay for the vaccine, even if we would produce it. And that persisted up to the present day. So this is another problem we have on our continent. There are issues that may be only specific to a particular region. Is it important to the people? Yes, it is. But the global financing will not finance that. We have to look for ways of local financing of these initiatives if we are going to engage very strongly in the 21st century global arena. Filing a patent costs money. It costs money. And if the university is going to protect intellectual property rights, an institute is going to do that, you must set aside money for paying, because it's not cheap. I had an issue with that vaccine social. My president was talking to me in Bangkok. He said, but you African scientists, you don't, you attend these conferences, we see people that are discussing new things, but we don't hear you talking about these new things. And say, for instance, I've got this disease which has been harassing our cows and no one has done anything about it. I said, yes, Your Excellency, I know the disease, it's called Scots fever. He said, huh? Yes, but Your Excellency, it is possible to do something about it. And he said, ah, but you know, my grandfather and my father used to tell me, if you're buying an animal, you must check whether it has recovered from this disease by checking for lymph glands behind the ears. And if the animal has not suffered and recovered, you don't buy. He said, yes, I know that. And then you see, when it has recovered, it becomes resistant. I said, yes, Your Excellency, except if you take those animals, for instance, you are paying bride price for your son, for your son's wedding, and you take your animals to another place, the strains are different, and the animals will suffer. He said, oh, you know, is that so? He said, yes. I said, however, there's another way. There is research which I've done, which shows that if you go for an antigen on the squirrel's white of the parasite coming from the tick, you actually can protect across the strains. Huh? Now, how can you take, that's the challenge, how can you take my father's and my grandfather's idea and then go and patent? And where is that patent? I said, but according to the institution I was working for, all discoveries become the property of the institution. So any IP automatically goes to the institution. It is now you have sold our intellectual property of our grandfathers and so on. So these are issues. But the thing is to contextualize the 21st century. But I encourage you to do the following. Basic research, essential. Go in it, but keep an eye on potential aspects that can be turned into policy, can be turned into entrepreneurship. And be aware that if you don't have an IP on it, you lose everything. If you have an IP on it, you are better protected. I did not want to speak for too long. I just wanted to share with you the journey I have taken in my nearly 30 years or 35 years in research, because that is, I'm a researcher by career, and I've been doing that for a long time. Now, some of the ideas that I gained from there, I have put in practice. At present, I manufacture vaccines for livestock diseases, I am not applying for patents on everything. A lot of what I now, since I now have the industrial base, most of the information is industrial secrets. I don't care if anybody tries to come here, they will not catch up with me. I thank you. I thank you very much.
Thank you very much.